Hi, and welcome to Smelling Coffee, a ministry of First Baptist Church in Cleveland, Mississippi. I'm Jennifer Walker, and we're so glad that you joined us today for this episode. I have with me today one of, I always say this, one of my favorite coffee mugs, but really this one, if you are a friend of mine on my blog, if you read my blog or go to my Smelling Coffee, Jennifer Crawford Walker and Smelling Coffee Facebook page, you will actually see a picture of this cup and saucer, because this is my favorite cup to have my quiet time with in the mornings. Usually my husband will get to the coffee pot first and he'll bring me a cup of coffee, and he knows this is one of my favorites. And I will sit with my coffee and spend my time with Jesus first thing in the morning. And so when I think about Smelling Coffee and the aroma of the knowledge of Jesus Christ in every place, which is what this whole ministry is based upon, I think about this cup. This is kind of my theme cup for Smelling Coffee. And the reason I brought it today is that I want to talk to you today about quiet times. In fact, this is a first of a two-part episode that we're going to do on quiet times and Bible study, how to open God's Word and how to fellowship with Him and commune with Him in what people call a quiet time. What is it? How do we do it? And then how to take God's Word and receive from it what your Bible teachers receive from it. And so this is the first of two segments we're going to do about that. And so today's segment is about a quiet time. What is a quiet time? Some people think a quiet time is just a time where you've got your coffee and you've got your newspaper and it's before everybody else gets up in the house, and it's just a time to relax. And that is a wonderful definition of a quiet time. But when I'm talking about a quiet time, I'm talking about a time to come away with Jesus when you let Him quiet your heart. That's what a quiet time means to me. It's a time where you sit at Jesus' feet. And a lot of times, this is what I have with me. I have my notebook, my journal, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. This is also my calendar. It's my everything. And I have my Bible, and I'll have a pen with me and a highlighter. So I've got paper, I've got a pen, I've got my Bible, and I've got my coffee, and I've got the quiet around me and just a time to be with Jesus. And so that to me is what a quiet time is. It's intimate, an intimate getaway with the Lord before your day really begins. A quiet time includes two elements. And the first one we're really great at, us talking to Jesus. We are great at praying and telling Him what we need and talking to Him about our days, but it also includes us listening to Jesus. In fact, James Dobson did a study or reported a study in one of his books on marriage about communication being the most important tool in marriage. And communication has to be a two-way thing, like where one person talks and the other listens, and then they trade places. And the one that was talking now listens while the other speaks. And when we want to communicate and have true intimate friendship and fellowship with the Lord, then we've got to have two-way communication with Him, where we talk to Him and then where we sit still with His Word, with pen and paper in hand, and listen to Him. And so I'm going to give you a really quick plan of how to do that today. But let me tell you this. Why do we want to have a quiet time? Some people might say, well, I don't really have time for this and I can't add one more thing to my day. Why would we want to have a quiet time? And so I want to give you a couple of reasons why we would want to have a time away at Jesus' feet. The first one is because of the extraordinary fact that the King of all kings wants to meet with you. Can you believe that? He is waiting to meet with you, to fellowship with you and with me. More important to Him than us serving Him is our fellowship with Him. That's why He created us. He does not need us to do things for Him. He can accomplish all of that on His own. But what He can't do is fellowship with us on His own. He needs us to fellowship with. That's why we were created, is to fellowship and enjoy His presence and display His glory. And so just the extraordinary fact that He wants to spend time with us should be a motivating factor that we would want to spend some time with Him. Another reason is that God is the boss, and we need to get our day's instructions for Him. He will give us encouragement. He will give us verses that we need. In fact, 1 Corinthians 1:9 says, God is faithful, reliable, trustworthy, and therefore ever true to His promise, and He can be depended on. By Him, you were called into companionship and participation with His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. He calls us into participation with Him and to companionship. That's kind of what we talked about in the first reason. And then into participation with Him. He has instructions for our day. He knows what's ahead and we do not. And so there have been so many times where I have had my quiet time in the morning. I've gone through the process that I'm going to share with you today. And I've written some things down, and then later on in that day, I have hit a difficult period, a tragedy has happened, or I have run into someone else that needs a word from the Lord, and I've got it right there from what He already gave me in my time alone with Him. He will prepare us for what is ahead because He's the only one that knows, and He is the boss, and He will help us make it through our day victoriously. Psalm 5:3 is a beautiful verse about getting up and coming away with Him in the morning so that He can prepare us for our days. It says, in the morning, you hear my voice, O Lord. In the morning, I prepare a prayer, a sacrifice for you, and watch and wait for you to speak to my heart. He will speak to us through His word in the mornings and give us instructions for our days. Well, a third reason to have a quiet time is that because God shapes and molds our lives through our fellowship with Him. He is the potter and we are the clay, and we need to come to Him so that He can take us and use His word to convict us and to remind us and to bless us and to love on us so that He can shape us to be what we need to be for that day and as we are growing in Him. And so He has a purpose for our lives, and He's the only one that knows that, and He will reveal little bits and pieces of it to us, but He is the potter. In fact, it talks about that in Isaiah 64:8. It says that He's the potter and we're the clay and we are the work of His hands. And so we need to come to Him and have some time with Him so that He could continue molding us into the people that He knows are our best selves. And then the fourth reason is that God empowers us for daily living. And for this, I want to take you to a passage that I love to teach on. And I wish we had so many more minutes in this program than we do, and I would really love to delve into it with you. But for today, I want to read to you Song of Solomon from chapter 2, starting in verse 10 through verse 16. And this is in the Amplified Version. It says, my beloved speaks and says to me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. For behold, the winter is past, the rain is over and gone. The flowers appear on the earth, the time of the singing of the birds has come, and the voice of the turtle dove is heard in our land. And it goes around along and talks about some other things that are blossoming. And then it says, arise, my love, my fair one, and come away. And this is the response, the one being called. And so I went with him. And when we were climbing the rocky steps up the hillside, my beloved shepherd said to me, oh, my dove, while you are here in the seclusion of the clefts of the solid rock, in the sheltered and secret place of the cliff, let me see your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. My heart was touched, and I fervently sang to him my desire. Take for us the foxes, the little foxes that spoil the vineyards of our love, for our vineyards are in blossom. She said distinctly, my beloved is mine, and I am his. He pastures his flocks among the lilies. God empowers us for daily living because he doesn't say in his word, and if we were walking up the rocky steps of the hillside, it said when we were walking. My beloved said to me, let me see your face. Let me hear your voice, for your voice is sweet and your face is lovely. And what this tells me is that he wants that fellowship with us, And he's not tired of us. He's not tired of us coming to him about the same problems and burdens. He doesn't hear our voices like we humans tend to hear the voices of those that we love, but that continue to say the same things over and over. We tune them out, don't we? He does not do that. He says our voices are sweet to him and our upturned faces are lovely to him. Isn't that beautiful? And so it says, when we were walking up the rocky steps, implies there's going to be rocky steps and he is going to be walking it with us. When we come away with him first thing in the morning and we come to him and we let him feed us with his word and fill us with his love, and we lift our faces up to him, then we will understand and remember the fact that he walks with us through the rest of the day. He is always present with us, but sometimes we aren't aware of his presence. And so it says, when we were walking, he said, oh, my dove, while you're here in the seclusion of this place, let me see your face. And so we are prepared for our days by coming away and turning our faces, bowing down, and then turning our faces up toward Jesus and letting him prepare us for the rocky steps of the day. There are some blessings that come from time alone with Jesus each day. And the first one is friendship and fellowship with him. Have you ever noticed that someone in your life might have a particularly close relationship with God, the Father, or with Jesus, and they talk about him like he's this real person that's right there with them all the time? You can have that too. That's what he wants for all of us by coming away and having a quiet time with him. You get to know him that way. A friendship is never developed in a passing moment, is it? If you want to be friends with someone, then you've got to put forth the effort to put some time into the fellowship and to put some investment of yourself, of sharing who you are, and then also listening as the other person shares who they are. And that's how we grow to know each other. That's how we grow to love each other more, how we feel close to each other. It's the same way with the Lord. And so we will grow in our fellowship and friendship with him. In fact, one of my favorite Bible study, he writes a book called Living God's Word, and it's how to study the Bible. So if you want, and how to walk with the Lord. So if you want to delve more into this subject, I would encourage you to get that book, Living God's Word by Wayland B. Moore. And in it, he gives this quote. He says, the process of knowing and experiencing God deepens in proportion to the time we spend with him in his word and in prayer. In his word as in talking to us, and prayer as in us talking back to him. So the second benefit that comes from a quiet time is that we will be more like Jesus. We will start to resemble him because we resemble those that we spend time with. We start to sound like those that we hang out with the most, that we're listening to the most. In fact, you know, they say that married couples, the longer that they live together, they start to look like each other. I have seen that to be true. They also say you look like your dog if you live with your dog for a long time. But they, there is evidence of us mimicking the other's actions and reactions when we spend a lot of time with another person. Well, that's going to be the same thing with Jesus. When we come away with him and spend time with him, then we're going to start to resemble him more. And that's really what he wants from us, is to bear and to reflect his image to the rest of the world that does not know him. And so he wants us to be image bearers and light bearers of him. We can't do that if we're not filled with him and if we don't look like him. And so those are some of the beautiful, wonderful benefits that come that we receive by spending time with the Lord. But he receives the benefit too. It's hard for us humans to understand, but he wants fellowship with us. He has called us so many times to come away. I've got so many verses here. I'm just going to read a couple of them where he is telling us to come away with him. In Matthew 4:19, he says to the disciples, come and follow me. In Song of Solomon 2:10, I just read that. My beloved speaks and says to me, rise up, my love, my fair one, and come away. Mark 6:31, he tells his disciples to come away by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while. Isaiah 55:1-3, he offers this to everyone. He says, come, you who are thirsty, listen to me, and your soul will revive. And in Matthew 11:28, He says, "Come, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." So in order to have that rest from the Lord and that fellowship with Jesus, just like building a fellowship with a friend, it takes several things. It takes a time, it takes a place, and a plan. We hardly ever just happen upon a very deep friendship with someone. Once we get to know them and want to develop a friendship, then we invest in getting together, a plan to get together later on. We think about what we're going to do, if we're just going to have coffee and talk, or if we're going to go do something active, you know, some activity together, whatever it is. We make a plan, and then we determine a place. Okay, where are we going to meet? Your house, my house, the track, whatever it is. And so it takes that same thing to meet with Jesus. So a time is what it takes first. And I've already talked about that a little bit, about setting aside time to come away with Him. You can do this any time of day, but many times in Scripture, when someone had something very huge and important to do, they would rise up early in the morning and do it. Jesus showed us this pattern in His own life. I've got a list of scriptures here that talk about that, about different people rising early in the morning to get to the task that God called them to. And I'm using the word task as just an activity that God called them to, because having a quiet time is not a task. But we see evidence of Abraham doing this, of Jacob, of Isaac, of Moses, of Joshua, of Samuel, of God's people, of David, and of Jesus. And so we see several different verses about each of these that rose up early in the morning. And that's what the scriptures would say. Jacob rose early in the morning and set up a monument of God speaking to him. Moses rose up early in the morning and built an altar. And he rose up in the morning and went up upon Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him. When God was going to give Moses the Ten Commandments and speak boldly to him, he told him to rise up early in the morning and come away. And I have tried this at all different times of the day, and I really believe that early in the morning, before your day gets started, is when we are positioned to hear him better and where he can give us what we need to make it through the day. If we wait until bedtime to acknowledge God's presence in our lives, then we've gone a whole day without him. Now, I'm not saying you have to have an hour-long Bible study in the morning. I have a 10-minute plan. If you're wondering where you can cram anything else in your morning, I want to ask you and challenge you, if you push the snooze button, either set your clock back 10 minutes earlier or decide not to snooze and give those 10 minutes to Jesus. And I promise you, he will give you back so much more than what you have given him. We can never outgive God. And so you will see a blessing and benefit in your life if you can give him 10 minutes. And then we need a place. It doesn't have to be this special fancy room, or, you know, the scriptures talk about going into your closet and praying, just getting away from the distractions. Every house we've lived in, I've had a special place that I meet with Jesus. And it varies from season to season. When my children are in school and they're up busy in the morning, it's a different place than when they're still sleeping and I have the freedom to get up and get to a nice spot in the living room. And so I've had a quiet time chair in my dining room and in my kitchen that I have turned toward the wall. So I will literally turn away from the distraction and face the wall with my Bible and my pen and paper and the Lord, and have that time with him. It does not have to be anything special looking, but it will become a special place to you. And so then you need to have a plan, and that's what we're going to talk about. I have a little page, just so that if you wanted to write these things down, you could hear it and see it and be able to remember it better. But this is a 10-minute plan to meet with the Lord. For the first minute, you just bow yourself down to the Lord and submit yourself to him. You can physically bow. You can bow your head. You can just bow your heart. You don't have to do anything extraordinary, but I love the ability. When I have the ability to bow down before the Lord, that act of just bowing myself down or even just laying my head down on the table gives me a physical picture of my submission to the Lord. And I just say, Lord, I acknowledge that you are the Lord of my life and I am not mine. I belong to you. So I give myself to you today. That took maybe 15 seconds. So it doesn't even take a full minute. So you'll gain a little time there. And then for 1 minute, praise and thank God for three of his characteristics and three things that that you are grateful for. And so you can go through a list of names of Jesus and just pick one. If you don't have a list, just think of some things about the Lord that you love and write those down and tell him that. You don't have to write them down. You can just say, Lord, I love it that you are the creator. And I can hear the birds singing this morning, and it's just incredible all that you made. So I praise you for being the creator today. And then you can go into a time of thanksgiving and say, and I thank you for nature. Thank you for having a house with windows that I can see the birds outside. Thank you for this day and what you have for it. You can do this in speaking. You can do this while you are walking to turn on your coffee pot. You do not have to do this while you're just sitting very still. So after you have bowed yourself before the Lord, you can get up real quick, be making up your bed while you're thanking and praising the Lord. But be aware that you've got a time limit and you want to stick to it. And I do too. And so we're going to have to rush through this so that we can get finished. And we'll continue this in the next segment. For 1 minute, ask God to create in you a clean heart. That's from Psalm 51:10. And, you know, sometimes we have way more than a minute's worth of sin to confess. But if you will stay confessed up during the day, when you sin and God, the Holy Spirit convicts you of it, and you get yourself clean from it, wash your hands immediately, and then you won't carry all that dirt into the next morning. But this is when I sit before the Lord and say, Lord, is there something else that I have not done that I need to confess, that I have not been aware of, that is a hidden fault of mine that I'm not, that I didn't know that I did. Lord, search me. From Psalm 139, it says, search me and try, know me and try me and see if there's any wicked way within me. And then bring me into the everlasting cleanliness of you, O Lord. I mean, just so many things in Psalm talk about that, about creating in us a clean heart and a strong, steadfast spirit. So I ask the Lord just to search me. And then whatever he brings to mind, I confess it right then and there, and I ask for forgiveness. And sometimes I write this down, sometimes I don't. So up to this point, there's nothing you have to write down. And then for 2 minutes or less, you can ask him to do these next things: fill me, cover me, shine through me, and speak to me. This really will not take but about 30 seconds once you get used to this. Again, this could be something you're doing while you're making up the bed. Fill me. Colossians 2:10 says that it is in union with me that you have been made full. And so after I've emptied out my sins, I just say, Lord, just I open my mouth wide and you fill it. That's from Psalm, I believe it's 84. And I just open up your mouth and just say, Lord, just fill my mouth today. Let me speak your words and not mine. Fill me with yourself. Fill me with your presence. Fill me with your joy. And then cover me in the armor. And I've taught on the armor in this Smelling Coffee TV before. And so you can go back, I think, and Google that on YouTube and catch that. But I just quickly go through the pieces of armor and put on the helmet of salvation that covers all of my eyes and ears and everything that I take in and that pours out from me. The breastplate of righteousness that covers my heart and all that I love and crave. The belt of truth that wraps itself around my waist and holds me up and frees me and gives me life and affects every breath I take. The shoes of peace that I stand on the gospel of the Lord Jesus and walk in him, and the shield of faith that I am trusting, standing behind him in trust and in faith, and the sword of the Spirit, his word that I've hidden in my heart, so that when I am tempted to sin, I've got a weapon to slash the enemy with. And so I just quickly go through those pieces of armor, and then I ask him to shine through me. Lord, just shine through me today. In fact, Isaiah 60 verse 1 says, shine, be radiant with the glory of the Lord, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. And I pray that the Lord would just shine through me and glorify himself through my body and through my life, through my hair, through whatever it is that I'm doing that day. And then I say, Lord, speak to me. Psalm 119, 18 says, open my eyes that I might behold wonderful things in your word. And this next segment, I'm going to talk to you about how to open up the word of God and get something from it and let the Lord really speak to you and to be able to write down and record what he says. So I'm going to skip that for now. And then But after the Lord speaks to you, and at this point for this week, if you don't know what to do, I would say open up your Bible to James, to the book of James or the book of Philippians, and just start reading it and just say, Lord, speak to me, and just let him speak to you, and he will. I promise you, if you ask him, he will. And then for 1 minute on your paper, write down what he said. Just write down the thing that you got that day. And we'll talk more about that in the next segment. And then for the last minute, pray that truth into your life. If the Lord revealed to you something about his forgiveness, then praying that back into your life would be saying, Lord, thank you so much for forgiving me. Thank you. I am resting in your forgiveness today. And then the 10 minutes would be over, but you take what God said to you and pray it into the lives of the other people, because you think, okay, what about my prayer list? What about the Wednesday night prayer paper and those kinds of things? How do you handle all the people that need prayer? You take the thing God has given you and you pray his word back into the lives of those that are on your heart. You can rise up at this point and go start brushing your teeth, get in the shower, and just be intentional about continuing your fellowship with the Lord. And so while you're doing those things to get ready in the morning, while you're driving to work, keep you a little list of people that you pray for each day, maybe a different list for each day, and pray for them, but pray the thing that God spoke to you about, and pray that God would reveal that to them in their lives. You can never go wrong by praying God's word. That is the number one most effective thing you can pray for someone, is pray God's word and an awareness of his presence over their lives. So as you go about your day, you are set up in 10 minutes for him to walk with you through the rest of the day, and you will feel that closeness. It's not all about feeling, but you will be aware of his presence in a special way that you might not have been previously. The presence of God's fellowship and the awareness of his personal involvement in your life will be a sweet blessing and a reward for all of those who seek him. In fact, Hebrews 11:6 says that he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So I want to pray for you as you this might be all new to you and you might feel overwhelmed a little bit right now, but I promise you, if you will give God 10 minutes and come to him, just bow yourself before him and say, Lord, I'm yours. Speak to me, convict me, cleanse me, fill me, cover me, and go with me today. You will have a walk with the Lord that you never knew was possible. Let me pray. Oh, Lord Jesus, I praise you that you want to fellowship with us, that you love us so much, and we just can't comprehend that. You've got so much going on that you would care to come away with me and talk to me and hear my voice, and you're not tired of my voice, and you're not tired of me coming to you about the same old things. You're not impatient. Thank you for that, Lord. I ask that this week, many will pick up your word and come away with you and give you 10 minutes. I pray that many will take this challenge and that you will start revealing yourself in the most amazing way in their lives. Lord, I pray that there will be testimony after testimony. If I never, ever hear about it, that's not the point. But I pray that each viewer will have a testimony of coming away with you and how ever present you have been to them during this next week. We love you, Lord, and we just thank you for your presence. Shine in, through, and upon us, O Lord. In your name I ask these things. Amen. Hope you'll join us next week for part two. And if you're watching this on YouTube, then check out part two of A Quiet Time and Bible Study, and you will be able to see that next week. Thank you for joining us today at Smelling Coffee, where we always seek the aroma of the knowledge of God in every place. Visit our church's website at underthesteeple.com, and I'd love for you to visit with me for more information on this and all kinds of other parts about life, love, and living it all in the aroma of Jesus Christ at my blog, smellingcoffee.com. May God bless you this week, and we'll see you next time. Hi, and welcome to Smelling Coffee, a ministry of First Baptist Church in Cleveland, Mississippi. I'm Jennifer Walker, and we're so glad you joined us today. This is actually part two of a two-part series that we're doing on the hows and whys and where and when to have a quiet time and Bible study. And I always introduce our segment with a coffee cup, and this is my Bible study coffee cup. This is the one that I drink out of most of the days, most of the mornings when I'm having my quiet time with Jesus. In our last episode, we talked about the difference between a quiet time, as in sitting at your table, reading your newspaper, and drinking your coffee, and then a spiritual quiet time with coming away and letting Jesus quiet our hearts. And so a quiet time that I'm referring to is not a time where we're just relaxing in the morning. It's a time where we're resting at the feet of Jesus. And we talked about a 10-minute method for your quiet time, and I have that here, a minute to submit yourself to Him. And if you want to go back, if you didn't see last week, you can catch this on YouTube. You can just put in YouTube, Smelling Coffee TV, and then put my name, Jennifer Walker, in there, and those episodes will pop up. But so 1 minute, submit yourself, bow down to Him, whether you can physically or just in your heart. 1 minute, spend some time in praise and thanksgiving. Another minute, spend some time in confessing. And this is the time where you ask Him to search your heart and see, where have I failed you, Lord? You know, and let Him show you things that you're not aware of. And then 2 minutes, asking God to fill you with His Spirit, and open your mouth that He got fill you, to cover you with His armor. So that's when you put on all the spiritual armor from Ephesians 6, to shine upon and through you to others, and then to speak to you. And we said Psalm 119, 18 says, open my eyes that I might behold wonderful things in your word. And then 3 minutes to get into the word. And that's what we're going to talk about today. And so we didn't really talk much about that yet last week. And then a minute to write down and respond what you got from the scripture. And then a minute to pray that into your life and into the lives of those that are on your heart. Now, this is certainly not an all-inclusive walk with the Lord. This is really what I like to call a McDonald's meal with Jesus. You know, there are dinners when you go out somewhere, linger over and you enjoy. One of my favorite places is the Melting Pot. And so I love a Melting Pot quiet time where there's plenty of time to just sit and savor. But in the busy reality of the world that we live in, many of us don't have time to go and sit at the Melting Pot for 2 hours for a dinner. Instead, we're going through the drive-thru at McDonald's to feed our families and ourselves. And so this is a quick way to start your day with Jesus. But I am in by no means saying that this is everything that you're ever going to want to do with Him for the rest of your life. This is just a launch pad. And what you're going to find is 10 minutes is not going to be enough. You're going to enjoy your fellowship with Him so much that you're going to want more time, and you're going to start setting your alarm back 5 more minutes extra and taking 15 minutes with Him. And then you're going to want 20 minutes. Some days you'll get it, some days you won't. But if we are intentional about whatever time we have and we give that to the Lord and ask Him to use it to speak to us and fill us, He will do it. In Proverbs 3, 9 and 10, it talks about the tithing, honoring the Lord with the first fruits of your increase, so shall your barns be filled with plenty. Well, as a stay-at-home mom who did not have a job that I earned any kind of income, I felt like the Lord spoke to me years ago about that passage, that was my time. My time was valuable. I could not sell it, trade it, store it. It's here for a second and then it's gone. And so if I could honor the Lord with the first, the best, the choice parts of my time every day, then He would fill my barns with plenty. And I've watched Him do this for the 30 something years I've been walking with Him and having a quiet time. He has been so faithful. When I lived in a big city and was trying to go somewhere, you know, I would get green lights. You know what I'm talking about. He has done that for you before when you have given Him what time you have in the morning. And so this was just a short way to start your day. Now, if you're taking a Bible study and doing a Bible study class, There is no way you're going to get to do your Bible study lesson in 3 minutes. This is just your breakfast with the Lord. You've still got all the rest of the day to sit down and have a good feast on His word, a meal. Jeremiah said that your words were found and I ate them, and they were to me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord of hosts. And so He wants us to come and eat and consume His word. You're not going to do that in 3 minutes. This is the drive-through version. So what I told you last week for 3 minutes was start reading in a book of the Bible and just ask God to speak to you, and then read for 3 minutes. When He speaks to you, stop, write it down, and then pray that into your life and go on and start getting ready and pray that word. Whatever He spoke to you, pray that for everybody else that you pray for. Today, though, I want to show you a method of Bible study that will get you a little bit deeper into hearing from the Lord, from His word. If you've ever wondered how your preacher or Billy Graham or Beth Moore or any of those Bible teachers that you listen to, and you wonder how do they come up with that, I want to tell you how they come up with it. This is a method that God showed me years and years ago, and it's what I do every day. When I come to the Word, I can't have a 10-minute quiet time anymore because I want more of Him. But if I'm rushing around, I do my 10-minute version. But if I have time, this is what I do when I come to just the raw Word of God. I love Bible studies. I've written Bible studies myself. I'm a proponent of people taking Bible studies. But I'm also a proponent of just opening up God's Word and asking the Holy Spirit to speak, and the thrill of having Him reveal Himself and reveal something to you from His word is unbelievable. And you'll see that the more you do this, when you start to open up Bible studies, you're gonna see that God told you, just the Holy Spirit, as you studied, the same things that your Bible study teacher is gonna teach you. And it's just really an amazing thing to walk with the Lord in this way. So I have lots of R's here. And so the first thing to do, we've already talked about it, is to request, to pray Psalm 119:18. Open my eyes that I might behold wonderful things from your word. Just before you open the Bible, ask God to open your eyes. And then the second thing is to start reading in God's word. Now, this is not serious inductive Bible study that I'm going to tell you about. This is the skimming the layer of opening His word and getting the top layer of what He might want to say to you through it. This is how I begin every one of my times with the Lord, and every message that He's ever given me to teach, to share, to write about, have all started this way from my quiet time. And then as I have gone through these steps and God just keeps impressing that same scripture on my heart, He's called me to go back to that and get deeper and study deeper and get out the concordances and get out the commentaries and get out the lexicons and really do some digging in it. But this is how to skim the surface and pull up some meat out of God's word. So you start reading in His word. I would encourage you to take a book of the Bible and start reading through that. The book of James is full of wisdom. It's a wonderful book to start piecing yourself through, just inching yourself through. And it's not real long, and so it's not like you're looking and thinking it's going to take a year to get through this. It's not. Philippians is another one. Any of Paul's letters, Psalms and Proverbs are wonderful. They are a bit longer. And when we do a segment in the future on praying for your loved ones, I'm going to talk about going through Psalms and Proverbs, but doing it praying through them instead of just studying through them. But I love the book of John, any of the Gospels, just about anything. I would encourage you to start practicing this method in the New Testament. I love, love, love the Old Testament, but it is a little bit harder to understand. Most of the New Testament was written to believers who were needing to learn how to consume God and His word and their faith and to grow in their faith. And so you will really be encouraged as you dig into some of these New Testament books. But don't just open up and just start in the middle of a book. Start at the beginning of the book of Scripture. And so you're going to read until something hits your heart. Now, you might read a verse You might read two verses. You might read a chapter or two chapters. It doesn't matter, because you are asking God to speak to you, and then you're going to put his word in your eyes and your ears and in your mind, and you're going to let him read his, you're going to read his word and let him feed you. And then something is going to stick out to you, a new idea, a thought about something, a conviction about something, a reaction of some kind, whether it's, oh Lord, I am so sorry, I didn't even realize that, or, oh wow, this is so neat, this is so cool, or you might react and say, oh, thank you, Lord, for this, thank you so much. You just might feel so blessed. Whatever it is, when you have a reaction, your first thing that gives you a reaction to the scripture, stop reading right there. You know, finish the verse and then kind of stop reading. You can go on if you're in the middle of if your Bible is in paragraph form and you're in the middle of a paragraph, go on and finish the paragraph. But you're going to stop right there. You're not going to keep plowing through more scripture, because you've got something God wants to deal with you about right there, and you don't want to miss it. So you stop. And then the number three is to recap. You're going to take what God showed you that's really stood out to you, and you're going to reword it in your own words. And so this is when you really do need a Bible, your pen, and a piece of paper. And what I do, and this is my journal. It's also my calendar and my notebook and everything else. But this is where I do this, and this is what I got this morning. And just a little bit over into here. But sometimes it's very short, and sometimes it's two or three pages. It just depends on what the Lord is saying to me and how much time I've got to dig into it deeper. But I take the date. So you would write the day's date here, and then you would put the verses that you read, and then you would write about it. You would paraphrase it in your own language. And you're going to respond to the Lord on this same piece of paper, because this is where you start to see you're talking back and forth to the Lord. You're going to see a tangible proof of that. And so you are going to recap what he said to you. And then you're going to reevaluate your own life in light of that truth. What do you need to do according to what God showed you? Do you need to change something? Do you need to start something? Do you need to stop something? Do you need to say something or not say something? Do you need to confess something, ask for forgiveness? Do you need to step out and help someone? Did God use his word to show you to do any kind of action? So look at your life and prayerfully ask the Holy Spirit to reveal to you if it's something you need to know or stop or start or do, and write that something down. So after you've paraphrased it right here, you're going to write down what you feel that the Lord wants you to do with it. Because see, this is making the scripture come alive. Hebrews 4:12 tells us that the word of God is active and alive and sharper than any two-edged sword. It's going to cut deep. This is starting to let it cut a little bit deeper than just saying, oh, that's a nice thought, and moving on with your day. Sometimes our devotional books give us nice thoughts, but that's as far as we go. We're reading somebody else's thoughts. We might read one verse of scripture and then a whole page of somebody else's thoughts on it. God wants you to hear his thoughts on his word. And so this is the beginning of that process of saying, okay, God, what am I supposed to do with what you've just given? And so you write that down. And then below that is number five, is respond. You're going to respond in prayer concerning what he told you. If he told you to trust him in an area that you've been real worried about, and so you're going to rewrite the verse in your own words, then you're going to write down, I need to trust God in this area. And then your respond section would be your prayer back to him. Oh God, help me. I am so afraid of blah, 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 but I know that I need to trust you. You have this all in your hands, and you are faithful, and I need to trust you. So help me to trust you in this matter, Lord. And be as specific as you can. You can write one sentence, two sentences, however many you want to write. What happens is, as you start to record these things, you're going to have a record of your walk with the Lord. And as you do this for a year, you've got a notebook full of 365 truths that God showed you and how it changed your life. After 10 years, you've got over 3,500 truths from God's Word. See, he teaches us his word line upon line, as we're told in Isaiah. Line upon line and word upon word, just a little here and a little there every day. And he starts to build upon what he has started in our lives as we come to him and say, open my eyes and let me see wonderful things in your word. And so it is in doing this and writing these things down and responding to him that you will start to see him work in your life. And then number six is to remember it. Is this a verse that you need to write down and remember? Sometimes there is a verse that I am just so convicted that I need to memorize, you know, that it's just obvious. This is one I've got to write down and commit to memory. And then other times, you know, it's not. And so the Holy Spirit will impress upon you if this is a verse you need to remember. Or is this a verse that you need to write it down and post it somewhere around your house? So sometimes it might not be one that you have to memorize, but it's one that you need to have with you. So you can write it down on little pieces of post-it notes or just corners of paper and just tuck it somewhere where when you put your hand there and you feel that paper, you know that that's that verse that God wants you to remember the truths from. And it's like God speaking to you all over again. And so then after we are asked about remembering it, you pray to recall it. You ask the Lord, Lord, help me to recall this today. Help me today, because it's so easy, y'all, to close the Bible, close your notebook, and go about your day and just forget the wonderful thing, the treasure that God just gave you. It's so easy for me to do that. And so if we will say, Lord, help me recall this, especially in times when I really, really need it, then he will help you, because one of the names of the Holy Spirit is the reminder, the one who brings to our remembrance all the things that God has said to us. So what Jesus told his disciples right before he died, he said, you know, and the Holy Spirit is going to come and he's going to remind you of everything that I taught you. And so you ask that Holy Spirit to remind you of what he has taught you. And then the last ones is to pray about revealing this to someone else. Is there someone else that gently needs to hear this word from the Lord? If it's an encouraging word, it's so much fun to take it to somebody and say, this is what the Lord spoke to me through his word today, and I just thought it might be a blessing to you. And share it. Don't just store it up and keep it for yourself. Now, if it is a convicting word, let me just remind you and tell you from personal experience, God is not very pleased when we read the Bible and the whole time we're thinking, man, my husband really needs to hear this, or my neighbor, she needs this verse right here. She needs to be convicted of this. This is her problem, not mine. You don't read the Bible for your friends, your neighbors, your family. You read it for yourself. This is one place where you can be selfish, where you can just grab all you can get of the Lord and his word for yourself. And when you do that, then he will pour it through you onto others, but he will pour it appropriately and humbly. And so if he reveals someone that you need to share a conviction with, then you don't do it unless you have prayed, you're covered in prayer, covered in the armor, and you go about it very gently and humbly. But you don't ever want to be accused of beating someone over the head with a Bible with a word of conviction. And that's what turns people away from Jesus and away from his word. And so you want to ask the Lord, is there someone who needs to have this revealed to them? And then last is keep repeating this process every day, and you will see the most incredible growth in the Lord. Now, as of just recently, there's a new method of Bible study out that's the same thing, but it is called the SOAP method, and this might be easier for you to understand. So real quick, we're going to go through it quickly, I should say. S stands for scripture. You're going to read the scripture and write down what stuck out to you. So that's the same as reading and recapping, okay? And then the O stands for observe. So you're going to look at this. Who is the scripture talking to? Observe around it. What is it that God is saying to you through it? Break the scripture down into small truths and write them down, even in bullet style, if you prefer. And that would be reevaluate and respond. And then application, the A stands for application. How can you apply this scripture to what you've observed in your life? What does God want you to do with what he's shown you in his word? And so this would be respond and remember and recall. And then the P stands for pray. That means pray the scripture, those truths, into your life and into the lives of others. So it's the same thing that we were talking about. Take his word and pray it over the people that you need to pray for that day. And then go about the rest of your quiet time or go about your day. You can sneak away with the Lord at lunch and just do this, you know, just this Bible study portion. But the coolest thing that I love it when God does this, just this morning, as I was studying my scripture, I happened to be in 1 Thessalonians. I was doing a name of Jesus, which was the God who is alive and true and genuine. And I just felt led to keep reading a little bit. And so I read on, and this is what I read. Verse 10 of 1 Thessalonians 1 says, and he's talking about something I don't have time to go into, but he says, he refers to Jesus. And then he says, this is Paul talking, he says, Jesus, and the Amplified, it says, who personally rescues and delivers us out of and from the wrath, bringing punishment, which is coming upon those unrepentant, and draws us to himself, investing with us all of the privileges and rewards of new life in Christ. And I just sat there and went, whoa, this is what Jesus does for us. So God just started, the wheels were just spinning. So I rewrote the scripture and I wrote down here and I said, Jesus, who personally rescues and delivers us out of the punishment and draws us to himself and invests in us privileges and rewards of new life in Christ the Messiah. And then in a bullet point form, so that was my scripture. And then my observance is I wrote in bullet point that Jesus, bullet point, rescues and delivers us. And I was thinking about that. That's enough, isn't it? We don't even deserve that. But he rescues us and delivers us from the death trap of sin on a daily basis. Of course, through his salvation, but then on a daily basis, he rescues and delivers us. And if that's not enough, bullet point number two, he draws us to himself. He doesn't rescue us just to leave us to fend for ourselves, but he pulls us up out of the pit and then takes his arms and wraps them around us and says, come to me, just like we talked about last week. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I'm going to give you rest. And not only that, he not only rescues us and draws us to himself, but then he bestows on us, he gives us the privileges and the rewards of new life in Christ the Messiah every day. What a gift. What a gift. This is huge. And so as I wrote that down and I thought, how can I apply this to my day? I just said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for this, that you have rescued and delivered me from self and sin and death, and you've drawn me to yourself, and you've given me fellowship and fullness and love and a new start each day. And then I ask him to forgive me and cleanse me from the selfishness that he has to daily rescue me from. And I ask him to help me feed the spirit and starve the flesh. And then I went on to pray, and I was thinking about some people that he might want me to share that with. And so I was speaking to a group of ladies this morning before I came to record this. And God just opened a door for me to share it with them, and it was great encouragement to them because they are in a program that is restarting their lives. And so to know that Jesus rescued and delivered them and then draws them to himself because he wants to, not because he has to, and then he will gift them with privileges and with rewards that come with new life in him. I mean, that's just so exciting to me. Isn't that exciting to you? And so as I went through the scripture and the observance and the application, you know, and then the prayer, I prayed it. I thanked God for it. And then I asked him, is there someone I can share it with? I've asked him to help me remember this when the enemy starts to plummet me with feeling overwhelmed again, you know, or maybe that I'm not good enough, or that that God is just tired of rescuing me all the time. And so I asked the Lord to help me recall this, to, and who can I reveal it to? And then and I prayed this into my life and in the lives of my children and my husband and those that are in my life and those that I am burdened for. And so that just makes, that's skimming the surface. Now, if I were going to speak at an event and I or do a Sunday school lesson or give a devotion, I would take what I found by this method or, you know, this method, which really is the same. I would take it. And then I would start breaking down those words. I would break down the word rescue and the word deliver and the word draw. And I would look up definitions for those words. And I would really just inch by inch go through that passage until I formed a whole message. And I know more truths would be revealed and it would be such an encouragement. And so James 1:22, this is the last P for soap that I've added in there myself. Put it into practice. Do it. Knowing the word is great, but doing it is so much more important. James 1:22 says, be doers of the word and not just hearers only. So the challenge this week to you is take the Bible, what you're reading through, and open it up and ask God to open your eyes and go through it. Soap it, do the soap method, or do the R method, whichever you want to do. And dig into the word of God this week, and I promise you, he will reveal himself to you. And then one day when you're listening to a respected Bible teacher that you know and love, you will hear that teacher say something, and the Holy Spirit will have already taught you just between you and God and the word, and you'll say, oh, I already learned that. That's something I already learned, because you came to the raw word of God and you ate it and you let it transform your life. Let me close this in prayer. Lord, thank you for your word. You send it forth and you heal. So I pray that that's what you would do this week to everyone who accepts this challenge. We love you, Lord, in your name. Amen. Thank you for joining us on Smelling Coffee today. I'd love for you to visit with me on my blog at smellingcoffee.com, where I have this information and where you can receive encouragement for all kinds of living under the aroma of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And visit our church's website at underthesteeple.com. We hope you'll join us again next week. And until then, may God bless you.